job talking about it already. And lastly, we'll talk about options for pregnancy prevention. So overall, like I said before, my really main goal is to increase the comfort level with adolescent females in discussing sex and pregnancy prevention in care pediatrician like me, whether if you're a neonatologist and you're one of my questions is, how many teens are really having sex, and have we noticed a change? So the CDC produces this survey every year about high school students. It's the High School and Youth Risk Behavior Survey, and they reported that a third of high school students are currently sexually active, and currently is defined as within the last 3 months. So if you've ever worked with a teenager and you ask them, are they doing something currently, they're thinking, not right now, no. Yesterday, maybe. Tomorrow, maybe. So I thought that that was really important to point out that it's that those are the people that are doing currently, that are currently sexually active. So this is just kind of a longitudinal look at that exact statistic, but since 1991, I thought it was really interesting. If you look at 1991 versus in 2013, when the last data point was, that really hasn't changed. So over here on your all's left, it shows that it's basically the same, except for the top, that blue line is the black population. I don't know if you can read the little fine print, but they're the only ones that have had a significant decline over the last 20 years. I don't know why that is, but it's very consistent for Caucasian and white. So even though we've seen a decrease in the teenage pregnancy rate, we haven't really seen a decrease in teens that are sexually active. But I was a little bit more interested than just how many are currently sexually active right now. So the CDC does break it down, and they do ask them, have they ever had sex? So about 50%, a little less, of teenagers grades 9 through 12 in the United States report that they've ever had sex. And alarmingly, 5.6% of those is before 13. Yeah, that's what I thought too. I was very shocked by that statistic. And so that made me think, I have never mentioned sex to a 12-year-old in the clinic ever. Should we start having this talk before they turn 13? And then teenagers are having multiple partners. In high school, 15% have said they've had sex with four or more partners. And a lot of this talk is about contraception, so I have to talk about contraception even in this part. The CDC looks at it, and about 60% say the last time they had sex, they didn't use a condom at all. So in my mind, I'm thinking, oh, well, it's probably because they're using some other kind of birth control, and giving them the benefit of the doubt, that 40% population is using something else, and that may be the case. But actually, 13.7% in their last sexual intercourse used no method to protect against pregnancy at all. And I think that shows that we have a lot of room for improvement to talk with these teens about considering what options they have. Again, all that information is from that Youth Risk Behavior Survey, and this is from the most latest data in 2013. So I think it's important to look where at home, like where do we stand? Is Tennessee better or is Tennessee worse than in the United States? And I looked at that, and overall we're about the same as the number that have had sexual activity at all. But we're not doing so good with the younger population. About 9% of people, of teenagers, say they had sex before 13. It was about the same for multiple partners, but we're not doing really good about talking about contraception because it's less of those that are protecting against STDs in pregnancy. And then about almost 20% said that they didn't use anything at all. So I think this shows the need that even though we're kind of on par with the rest of the United States, this is an issue that in Tennessee that we really should be addressing. Oh, I kind of broke down that statistic that shows that if you look at about 20% not using any kind of method, that's considered 1 in 5 in our area of teenagers that are at risk for an unintended pregnancy. So if anyone has any teenagers, 12 to 17, think about that for yourself, but also for your population that you see every day. So always, this number of 17, that's when kids start having sex, is stuck in my mind. And I think that's because I've read it in multiple textbooks. But I really wondered if that was still true. You know, is that the latest data? So Guttmacher is an organization that is an institute that's done 50 years of study on sexual and reproductive health. And they have a lot of statistics. In different journals, and they also publish their own journals, and they looked at when did kids actually start having sex, because that number to me at starting below 13 was so alarming. But if you look, the females are in that dark orange color, and most of them do start around between 17 and 18, with about 70% or so having sex by the time they are 18. But of note, and I just want to point out that group from 10 to 13, they look like little tiny numbers compared to the rest of the graph. But that's still a population that we might be missing and talking with. And then so I did talk about contraception in that last slide, and that there's a big population that we are kind of missing and that we have room for improvement. But I do want to mention that we've made leaps and bounds over the last 30 years. So the dark orange color on this graph is those that have used condoms, and then that light orange color of those that have used some other kind of method to protect against pregnancy. So if you look at 1982 to 2010, we have made a big effort in making contraception easy to access and for teens to be able to protect themselves. So even though we do have a large percentage that still aren't using contraception, we've made a lot of improvement. So that Guttmacher organization did have a study that was published in Pediatrics in about May of 2013, and they looked at sexual initiation, contraceptive use, and primary among young adolescents. So we looked at older adolescents for quite some time, 16, 17, and 18, but it wasn't until recently that they started looking at that younger population, and they have this graph here that I think is a good point, is they looked at who is using contraception at what age. So their kind of conclusion from this graph, if you look like the dark blue at the bottom is the younger population, and as they go up is kind of older. Their conclusion that those kids that have sex before they're 14 never use contraception, and then, well not never, but they're least likely to use it, and then as they get older, they're the least likely to adapt it. So if you have a kid who starts having sex, the younger they are, the more time it will take for them to realize, oh, I need to protect myself against pregnancy. So why aren't kids protecting themselves against pregnancy? You know, I could probably think for a number of reasons, but trying to get in an adolescent's mind is really difficult. So there's this national campaign to prevent teen and unplanned pregnancy that have done a lot of surveys and looked at why teens aren't protecting themselves. And teens report about 68% of them just don't use it because they're afraid their parents will find out. When adults were polled on the same survey with the same kind of question, we said, they don't really care. About 48% was different. So like I said, it's kind of difficult to imagine what an adolescent is thinking. So adults really need to realize that we may be the reason ourselves that the kids aren't protecting themselves. And a lot of that has to do with moral, ethical, and religious beliefs. And everyone has their own. And so you may be sitting there thinking, well, I'm not going to prescribe contraception because it's against my religious belief. And I think that everyone at the end of the day has to go home and put their head on their bed. And so that's a decision that you guys have to make. But I'm just presenting from the medical standpoint and data and statistics that do show that talking about it and having it as an option for children is decreasing the pregnancy rate. So I want to talk about some outcomes of teen pregnancy. So while I was looking at things online, I was very impressed with the amount of data that's out there for teens, and it's very teen-friendly, these nice, really pretty graphics and really good language. And the National Campaign for Teen and Unintended Pregnancy is one of those, and that's who I got this graphic from. And so that language is kind of geared towards more of that adolescent population. And one of the things that they note is that less than half of teen moms never graduate from high school, and even less of those get a college degree before they're 30. And one reason that adolescent girls think about having sex or wanting to have a baby is to make that boyfriend that they love so dearly stay. And they have statistics that show that that doesn't really happen. So 8 out of 10 dads aren't going to marry the mom of their child. And then also looking at socioeconomic status of what these happen to these babies and these mother, they're 9 times more likely to end up in poverty. So at the bottom, I did a little bit more about medical data, what means most to, well, not most to me, but is definitely important to me, is what happens to these babies. I don't know how many times just in pediatric training that I've seen a baby come in with a 15, 16, a 17-year-old mom. And I think raising a baby is hard. I can't imagine raising a baby as a 16-year-old. And I definitely can't imagine raising a baby as a 16-year-old with a medical problem. So I think conveying that to our patients is that they're more likely to be delivered premature, they're more likely to have low birth weights, and we all know the outcomes of when you have a premature or low birth weight baby. They're more likely to have a chronic medical problem, more likely to be intellectually disabled, and not to mention death. So I definitely think that is a reason for all of us in this room to think about talking about teenage pregnancy and ways to prevent it. Other socioeconomic things that I found are sons are more likely to end up in prison, and daughters of young teen mothers are more likely to become a teen mother themselves. So if that's not enough, I wanted to look at the teenage pregnancy statistics of how many teens are actually getting pregnant. And in 2013, there were over 250,000 babies that were born to teenage women. And if you like numbers and like money, if you look at this from a taxpayer dollar standpoint, that's at least $9.4 billion in cost to U.S. taxpayers. And that includes things like health care, foster care, as well as lost tax revenue because of the lower education of these moms that are getting pregnant. Again, I like to look at it a little bit closer to home. What does it look like in Tennessee? So the last data that I could find was in 2010, when there were over 13,000 pregnancies born to teenage moms. And if you look at that compared to all 50 states, we're ranked number 34. So we could definitely do a little bit better. And that public cost just in that year alone was $230 million. But if you looked over the last 10 to 20 years, it's a whopping $6.2 billion. And then just yesterday, I was looking for birth rate for Johnson Medical Center for my MMM, and I stumbled on this Mountain States Health Group Community Assessment Needs, and it broke down teenage pregnancy by live births. And it broke it down by county, which I thought was really interesting. So, of course, I just had to add it in. So, in Tennessee, we have 37 teenage mothers in 1,000 live births. If you look at it, Washington County, we're doing a little bit better than the state of Tennessee, but the surrounding counties aren't really doing that. With Johnson County, which I believe is Mountain City, there's 50 per 1,000 live births of babies born to teen moms. So again, this just showed me that this is something really important that we need to be talking about with our patients. So kind of through the talk, I have a couple of little myths of things kind of scattered out, common misconceptions of people. And this was one of my own misconceptions. So I looked at, I always thought, man, that show, 16 and Pregnant, a Teen Mom, or that movie Juno, which kind of walks through a relationship of a teenage girl and her boyfriend, and they get pregnant and raise this baby. Like, that is not doing us any good. Aren't more kids going to say, oh, look, it's okay to have a baby? But actually, if you look over the last few years, there's been a significant decline in the pregnancy rate. So that top black line is the pregnancy rate, and the dark orange line is the birth rate. So you can see significant drops in that. And actually, there was a paper that was done or published at Wesleyan College National Bureau of Economics. I'm not sure why the economics team was looking at this, but I thought it was very interesting. And what they did is they looked at Google Trends and social media accounts before and after these shows and movies started airing. And they noticed a significant increase in Google searches for contraception and teenage pregnancy. And like I said before, I just did a little search on teenage pregnancy, and there's all kinds of things that come up. The National Campaign for Unplanned Pregnancy, bedsider.org, sex, etc. That's what these kids are looking at. And there are several comments that after a show aired, even on Twitter, that says, man, 16 and pregnant, that's the best birth control. So, you know, this is a very low-powered paper that they did. A lot of things are concluded from it. They may be drawing a lot of lines, but they even did notice on their little poster on the left that other things play a factor. So I think we have to consider, you know, that maybe that the TV shows that are showing what it's like to be a teenage mom with a baby aren't really hurting us like I once saw. They may actually be teaching teenagers to say, hey, I don't want that. But other things do play into that as well. And I think one of those things is us, those parents in education and schools, we definitely should be having, we are having more open discussions about contraception, and we're making it a little bit easier to access. So with that being said, I wanted to go into like, how do you talk about it? How do we become open to talking about sex with teenagers? Because I just remember being an adolescent and like having the talk is awkward for both, for everybody. So if we're a little bit more comfortable and we make it a little bit normal, they may feel that way too. So I think it was JAMA of Pediatrics in 2013, they did this survey, or actually this one was a study, in North Carolina, and it looked at sexuality talk during adolescent visits. So I think it's really important. You know, we think we do a really good job about talking about sexual history and contraception and confidentiality with our patients. But this group in North Carolina looked at how well we really do. And it wasn't a retrospective study of me saying, oh yeah, I talk about it in every visit with every patient. They actually recorded all of the health maintenance visits. And so the health maintenance visits included sports physicals, new patient visits, and those already established patients that were coming just for wheelchair care. If it was a chronic care follow-up for your asthma or the patient had a chronic condition, they had kind of excluded those from the study. So they looked at patients between 2009 and 2012, and they looked at kids that were 12 to 17 years old. And they looked at kind of three things. They looked at what sexuality talked about, and they include any kind of comment, any kind of question, discussion. It could even be 2 seconds, they counted it. Who initiated the discussion? And did we talk about confidentiality at all? And I thought it was really interesting. They looked at 253 adolescent patients. They looked at 49 different providers. And those included private care, primary pediatricians, as well as academic pediatricians. And they spent an average of 22 minutes in the room, but they only spent 36 seconds talking about sex. I was surprised because in the article they even mentioned, if you just read Bright Futures Anticipatory Guidance about sex, it takes longer than 36 seconds. And that's kind of the gold standard for anticipatory guidance. About 65% of the visits had any kind of sexuality content in it, but only like 33% of them were just yes or no answers. So there was no discussion. It was, are you sexually active? Yes. Have you thought about birth control? No. And then only a third of them talked about confidentiality at all. So they kind of made some kind of long-term conclusions from this study. The average age of the physician was 40, and they were mostly female, so the data may be skewed because of that. But they noticed that those that are, if we're talking with females, if we're talking with African Americans, or if we're talking with an older adolescent, we're more likely to talk about sex than if it was those other population. So I found this really interesting because I know as pediatricians we feel like that we do a great job and that we always talk about sex, but this shows that maybe we don't talk about it as much as we should, and maybe we don't talk about it as often as we think we are. So just kind of how do you have that conversation with your patients? So first off, with any adolescent patient that you're taking a social history, I feel like you have to really set the stage to have that discussion. So you have to make the adolescent primary historian. It's really easy to go in and mom's sitting there with her to-do list of things to talk to you about and greet mom first. But instead, just start by greeting the adolescent or greeting even your younger child first. So that makes them engaged in the conversation and helps build trust. Also, you should always talk about confidentiality when you're talking about these things. So I have a slide just about confidentiality. We'll talk about that in a minute. But using understandable language, if you use things like coitus or intercourse, they're not going to have a clue what you're talking about. So use the word sex. Don't be afraid of it. And be non-judgmental. So watch your body language, because teens can really read that. And watch how you say certain things, because if they think that you're judging them, they're not going to tell you anything or want to talk about anything. And then most importantly, listen to your teenager. I think you can learn a lot just by watching their body language and how they react. So a little bit about confidentiality. So I don't know if there's a right way or a wrong way to have this conversation, but I think there are some things that we should all consider as kind of a basis. So there is data that shows that if you tell the patients that this is confidential information, that they're more likely to open up and trust you and seek care. Now, whenever you're talking about confidentiality, you have to tell them there are three reasons of why the things are not going to be kept confidential. They're going to harm themselves, if they're going to harm someone else, or someone else is harming them. Then that you are obligated to report that to someone, and then that could no longer be kept confident. And also, you have to talk about billing. So, you know, if a kid comes in and they're wanting to know about contraception, wanting you to prescribe something, wanting you to treat for STDs, which I'm really not going to talk about today, you have to let them know, hey, I'm not going to tell your mom. The law says I doesn't have to, but your insurance might. And so that is really important as well, in kind of disclosing things to them. And I do think it's always important that if a patient does disclose something to you and they don't want their parents to know, that you encourage them to talk to their parents about it. That is not always done, but you should always kind of engage that in that conversation. And I think that everyone here knows that the best way to get a patient to have a good open discussion with you is just have the parent leave the room. And there are many ways to do this, and I'm not saying that my way is the best way or not, but I feel like at a certain age, you tell the mom, hey, listen, Cassie is now 13 and she's a teenager, so there are some things that I just want to talk to her by herself. You know, that really gets her practicing of taking care of herself and kind of maturing into an adult. And usually parents are like, oh, okay, sure, and then they leave the room. So I've seen it done a lot of ways. That's just the way that I do it. And then, you know, I think it's important wherever you go to kind of know what your confidentiality laws are. They differ by state, the age of consent, can you give this adolescent contraception, can you treat their STDs? Again, I'm not going to really talk about STDs, but I do want to mention that in the state of Tennessee, that any minor who's seeking out reproductive services does not have the consent, have to have a consent of a parent, as well as for STD treatment. So wherever you are in the future, know what your governing body says, what you are, because you don't want to get yourself into a legal battle. And then just on that note, if you aren't able to provide confidential services, knowing what kind of resources you have to offer your patient is really important. So most offices will have some kind of policy. If you're in private practice yourself, it's recommended that you develop a kind of confidentiality policy and knowing that. So just briefly about the social history, I was always taught heads in medical school, and when I went to the National AAP conference, one of the lectures I attended was about talking to teens, and he presented a new option called SHADES, And so basically what Shades is it's just a little bit of a rearrangement of heads, and it's more to gear in towards motivational interviewing and starting off with strengths and schoolwork. So what kind of things are you interested in? What kind of things do you like to do? How's school going? And that kind of also gives you some goals and things to play back when you get down to these more sensitive questions about sexual activity and safety. So when you're taking a sexual history, I think it's really important to talk about five different things. And the five P's is one way that I learned it. And I've got some sample questions so that maybe we're not just using yes or no answers. So number one with partners, are you interested in males, females, or both? Instead of, do you have a boyfriend? Have you ever had sex? Have you ever thought about having sex? If you are having sex, what kind of methods are you using to prevent STDs? Have you ever had an STD? Have you ever been pregnant? What are you doing to prevent pregnancy? And you know, sometimes they may say, oh, I'm not having sex, and that's great, and you should tell them that that's great. But also, well, if you decide to have a sexual relationship with someone, do you know what your options are to prevent pregnancy and to prevent STDs? And that kind of gives you a leeway of being able to discuss it, or they can open the floor and be like, well, really, my boyfriend not thought about, you know. So it more brings in open conversation rather than those yes or no answers. So just some kind of do's and don'ts. Don't just use sexually active, because as the study showed earlier, you're really like, they're going to think then and now. No, I'm not, but 2 months ago I was. And don't use gender-based pronouns. I really wanted to squeeze in some things about the lesbian and gay population, but for time I really just couldn't approach that. And like I said before, don't use judgmental language. And even though I said use basic words, don't use slang words unless they offer them first. And then all of the other things are kind of what I've already went over. And I do have a slide about motivational interviewing, but I'm gonna skip past it so that we can talk about birth control. So knowing your options for birth control, I remember last year, and I was pregnant and sitting down with Dr. Chastain, and a girl came in and asked about birth control, and I knew about two things, and he was like, obviously, I'm just kidding. So we started talking about all of these different options, and I was completely overwhelmed. So not only can you be completely overwhelmed about the number of oral contraceptive pills, but just the number of options that are available. So this little nice graphic is from bedsider.org. that I kind of put in what everything is, because some of them I didn't know. And I'm not going to talk about some of them, like the female condoms, the diaphragms, the sponges, and cervical pads, because those you can just buy over the counter. It's not something that we're going to be prescribing. And then sterilization is a permanent method of contraception, so that I don't think that's a great option for many of our adolescents. There was a little circle there for a reason. So I do want to talk about abstinence. So, of course, the only reason that you're never, ever going to get pregnant is you just don't have sex. And so I think that's very important to mention to our patients at the beginning of every conversation. But there's been some evidence that shows that the abstinence education in schools isn't really making a difference, and that two-thirds of the female patients say that they were never talked to about other methods of contraception. So I think that's where we kind of come into play. There is a survey that was done that looked at pediatricians' beliefs and prescribing patterns. And just for the sake of time, I'm going to summarize it. And basically what the article says is that the reason that we're not offering like a long-acting contraceptive to an adolescent population is because the providers themselves aren't comfortable with it. So this survey was done by pediatricians and pediatric residents, and they were saying they don't feel comfortable prescribing contraception because, number one, is 50% said because they didn't feel comfortable with talking about it or prescribing it, and number two was they said they felt like it was the OBGYN provider's responsibility. And I'm not sure that that's necessarily true. And so that's kind of just the summary. I have lots of different data, but I really want to talk about IUDs themselves. So how do you decide what's best for your patient? There's a lot of things to consider. How well does it work? teenagers want to know if they can hide it. They want to know what it's going to do to their body and how much it's going to cost. And this is a great diagram by bedsider.org that you can even have posters made and put in your clinic. So it basically ranks about how well they work, and I think it's a great talking tool. So at the top is your long-acting contraceptive and sterilization. I don't think that sterilization is a great option for adolescents, but the IUDs and the implants have the same failure rate of about 1% of pregnancy on these methods, and all of the others are based ranked on how they work. So they, in the vital signs for CDC, they looked at how many people, teenagers, are actually using these long-acting methods, and only 4% are using implants, and 2.8% are using IUDs, even though they've been shown that they are a great option for adolescents. And I just want to take a minute to show you guys a video. There is a contraceptive choice project that's done in Missouri, St. Louis, Missouri, at Washington University. It's funded by the Department of Human Services, so it's not funded by any of the IUDs or implant companies. But I just want you to see what kind of study they've done and what kind of outcomes they've had.
Women have many paths available to them. How far to pursue an education, what career to choose, how to save or spend money, whether or not to marry. But an unplanned pregnancy can cut off those pathways. Unintended pregnancy affects women and men of all ages and income levels. Teen mothers are less likely to complete their education and tend to end up or stay in poverty. Women may have to put their careers on hold. Families suffer financially. And unplanned babies are more likely to have low birth weight and other health issues that can affect them their whole lives. Unintended pregnancy has national consequences. Half of all pregnancies in the United States are unplanned. That's 3 million unplanned pregnancies a year. And U.S. taxpayers currently pay $11 billion annually to cover unplanned births. But not all unplanned pregnancies are followed by birth. More than 40% end in abortion. That equals 1.2 million abortions in the United States every year. Why do we have this problem when birth control is available? Some women don't have health insurance or have plans that won't cover birth control. Some must weigh the monthly expense against college textbooks or even against the electric bill. Other women don't follow the rigid schedules required by the pill, patch, and ring. In the real world, these methods have a 9% failure rate, and for women under 21, the risk doubles. If they all have a shared goal of reducing unplanned pregnancy and abortion, it's time to look at what really works. Long-acting reversible contraception, otherwise known as LARC, is safe, easy to use, and highly effective. LARC methods include IUDs and subdural implants. Because they don't require anything of the user, such as taking a pill at the same time every day, LARC methods have an extremely low failure rate, less than 1% of users. In real-world tests, LARC methods were 20 times more effective than the pill, patch, and ring, but fewer than 10% of American women actually use them. Why is that? While some women can't afford the initial cost, most women simply don't know about LARC methods. Often, healthcare providers just offer the pill, which cuts off a woman's options. She can't take a path if she doesn't know it's there. Things could be different if more women were aware of LARC methods. The Contraceptive Choice Project in St. Louis provided 9,256 female participants with education and access to all birth control methods at no cost. Without knowledge or cost barriers, 75% of choice participants chose LARC methods. And because the majority of women in choice use the most effective methods, their unplanned pregnancy rate is only 35 for 1,000 women. Compare that to the national rate, a 52 per 1,000 women. And remember those 1.2 million abortions? That's the same as the national rate of 20 per 1,000 women. Choice participants had an abortion rate of only 6 per 1,000 women. If women nationwide had access to LARC methods, we could potentially prevent up to 1,060,370 unplanned pregnancies and 873,250 abortions every year. If we're serious about reducing unintended pregnancy and abortion, we need to be serious about doing what's been proven to work. Women need education about LARC methods, access to the birth control method that works best for them, and a way to get contraception at an affordable cost. Who knows what can happen when those pathways to education, work, and financial stability stay open? The possibilities are endless. You can help women stay on the path they've chosen. Please, pass this video on.
So I think that that's a really interesting study that they've done, and I do need to point out that it's not just in adolescents that they are doing this study, and their clinic is still open, and they are still studying these women that have made these choices. They have women in their study from 14 all the way to 45, of different varying degrees of education and race. And like the video said, they've got 75% that are choosing implants and LARCs. And it talked a lot about the barriers. And the good thing about their clinic is they eliminate the barriers. And a lot of the times we may not have the opportunity to do that with insurance and cost, but we can definitely eliminate the barrier of us. As that study showed, that we just don't know about it, we feel uncomfortable with it. So I would really like for everyone here to be able to feel comfortable about talking about LARCs and offering that method. And then they did look at kind of continuation rates, and this slide here shows that they looked at them a year later, and 80% of those that chose to do some form of long-acting contraceptive still were using that method, whereas if they chose some other method, only about 55% of those were still using that method. So we're not just talking about a few months, we're talking about years, and they're continuing to look to see how long that continuation rate goes. So you may be like, I've never heard of this IUD or an implant. Tell me more about it. So there are three different types of an IUD, and there's Mirena and then there's Skyla that both have the same hormone differing on the amount of hormone that's in there. And then the Paragard is a copper IUD. And they're very small, fit in the size of your hand. And they are placed by OBGYN provider, which may be one reason that the providers earlier said they felt like it should be a discussion by OBGYN. But I still think that as pediatricians, we can initiate that talk. One of the myths that people have is that, well, my patient is really high risk for STDs. I can't put in an IUD or can't refer them for an IUD because they're going to get PID. The IUD does not cause a PID. Chlamydia causes PID. So if you treat chlamydia, then you're not going to have PID. So it's a common misconception about the intrauterine devices is that it's going to decrease fertility or you're going to have to be more at risk for developing PID. And that's just not true. And there's significant evidence in the OBGYN literature to support that. The other thing was, well, this is an adolescent female. She's never been pregnant. It's just not an option for her. That's not true. Skyla's been made to work for 3 years, and it's much smaller for a nulliparous woman. And they looked at pain scores, and they're really low, about the same as they are for a woman that has had a child. So don't be afraid to have that talk. And if that comes up in the clinic, well, I've never had a baby. I can't have this placed in, and that's not true. So what are the contraindications to placing an IUD? Well, if you are pregnant, we can't put in an IUD. If you have a distorted uterine cavity, it's probably not the best option for you. And in the contraindications, a current PID is listed there, but if you treat the PID, then you can place in the IUD. It's a lot of acronyms. So what does this look like? I think it's nice to kind of know what we're talking about and prescribing. And I have seen one place, but if you look on the right, is this? That's the applicator where they go in to push the Skyla through the uterus. So you can see here, this is the Skyla. It's very small, and this one here is a Mirena. It's a very soft, flexible, that fits in the palm of your hand. So what kind of side effects you would have? Side effects, usually you can have some light spotting the first 6 months, which is sometimes enough for the adolescent to say, I don't want that. But then 40%, have no periods at all. And so that might be enough for them. I apologize. And then there's the implant. So the implant is that white stick that's over there next to the matchstick. That's about how, the size of it. It does have progesterone. Apologize. That does inhibit ovulation, and it's good for 3 years. My boy's going to completely go. But they most likely will have no period, but they might have infrequently bleeding. That's the most common reason that adolescents say, take this thing out. Let's figure out a different option. But it does have a failure rate of 1%. So they're really easy to place. When I was at the National AAP conference, I went to a lecture on pregnancy prevention, and they actually have primary care pediatricians that are placing these in the office. So if you have a referral rate that's high enough for adolescent females, the Nexplanon and Implanon representatives will come to your office and train you how to place them. So this is just a diagram of the Nexplanon. It comes in the applicator. You just put it in at 30 degrees and basically just put it under the skin, and it's good to go for 3 years. The Implanon is kind of the same thing, looks a little bit scarier because it looks like a huge needle. But the compliance rate with these are very good. And a lot of people in that study before said they were worried about the compliance rate. But with an IUD, you need 2 visits to the doctor, one to put it in and one to take it out. The CDC does recommend that you follow up at a month just to see how things are going. And the same thing with the implant. Whereas with Depo, which is another common method that adolescents are choosing, or the shot is what they call it, which is a progesterone-only injectable that you get every 3 months. So you're having to come to the doctor every 3 months. So your compliance is actually a little less. There is concern about the Depo, about weight loss or weight gain and bone loss. So this is one of the reasons that pediatricians are concerned about prescribing this patient, and they're worried about their obese patients. So a myth is that you just can't use this option, but it's been shown that they're actually safe. You just have to counsel your patients about. Sorry. But it actually doesn't increase weight gain. It increases your appetite, which will cause you to gain more weight. So it might not be the best option for your obese patients. And then there was evidence initially that you may have decreased bone mineral density on the Depo Premera. But now there's new evidence out that shows that that's not true, that your bone mineral density is very comparable to that in pregnancy. And then after you finish, or you're finished with the Depo, then your bone mineral density recovers. But the American College of OBGYN is still recommending that we don't do Depo Premera for more than 2 years. So it is important for us to recommend, like we do for all of our adolescents, to do calcium, vitamin D supplementation, and do regular weight-bearing exercise. The other option that I was most familiar with before I started studying this was oral contraceptive pills, and I debated putting in a lot of different pills in here, which I'm glad I didn't because we're running out of time, but basically they contain estrogen and progesterone, and there are several different formulations. And I think it's important to adopt a couple that you are very familiar with and know the side effects and how to prescribe them, but I'm not going to go in depth with that today. But there are some contraindications, clotting disorders, histories of clots, lupus, if you have a migraine with an aura or uncontrolled hypertension, this is not the best option for your patient. And those that are smoking and over 35, I had an adolescent in clinic that was a smoker, and she was 16, and I was like, well, we can't do the pill. And her trust saying, well, that's not true. We can counsel her to stop smoking, but she's not technically over 35. Now, it may not be the best option while she's smoking, especially as she gets older, but it's not a true contraindication. I'm not going to talk about missed pills or what to do if there's vomiting or diarrhea, but just so you guys know, on the CDC website, there's a nice pamphlet that not only talks about oral contraceptives and what to do with side effects, it talks about all of the different medications and how you manage them in routine follow-up. So I'll just let you guys look at that, knowing that it's there. Also, there's the patch, which is very similar to oral contraception. It's a beige-colored patch, and it's just like OCPs, where you do 3 weeks on, 1 week off. But there are 9 days of medication in each patch. So if for some reason your adolescents forgot to change it, then they're still covered. The goal is to place it somewhere on your arm, torso, buttocks, not on the breast because of the hormones, and you stick it directly to the skin, and you ask them to have a patch change a day. So I think it's important to talk about starting the day that they ask you, because they're more likely to use it if we start it on the day they're seen in the office. So if they're seen on Tuesday, Tuesday's your patch change day. If for some reason they don't want to have a period, you just skip that week off and they can be continuous without a period. If they do have a period, even if they're still menstruating, you put on a new patch. The other option is a Nuva ring, which is the same hormones, just in a different format. Can you see the ring? But it's a flexible, unfitted ring that goes into the vagina. A lot of adolescents don't like this because they have to touch themselves, and that's just weird to them. So if this is an option that they're considering, you can take a tampon, take the tampon out, put the Nuva ring in the plastic applicator, and insert the Nuva ring that way. They can also use this continuous, or if they really want to have a period, you can do 3 weeks in, 1 week out. Again, about missed and late periods, about what to do. I'm just going to let you guys look at that at the CDC for time constraints. And then emergency contraception, there are a lot of options out there. I'm not going to talk a lot about that. But Ella is the newest option. It's the most effective option. If your patients are on oral contraceptive, you can do like the YPSI method, where you take pills based on what kind of contraception you've prescribed. There is a list if you take 4 pills this day, 4 pills that day. But that's the least effective, so I didn't really want to mention much about that. But knowing that Ella you have to require a prescription for it, and that Plan B and Next Choice, in some states, they're sold right next to the condoms. But not here. You actually have to go over to the counter, or I didn't see it at Walgreens and Walmart, so I'm assuming you have to go over the counter to get it. I think it's important to kind of change our conceptions about emergency contraception. A large part of the population still thinks that this is an abortifacient, so they don't feel comfortable prescribing emergency contraception. It's not an abortifacient. It prevents implantation into the uterine wall, which is the medical definition of pregnancy. Sorry, I kind of ran over on time a little bit, but basically my goals for you when you leave here today, I want in your practice, when you're talking with an adolescent female, to feel comfortable talking about sexual activity, discussing contraceptive with the patients, and then lastly, knowing that long-acting contraceptives are your most effective method and are truly a really good option for your adolescent females. And there's kind of a list of the resources and things. And then we can take questions if needed.
Thank you. It was very clear and very well-structured presentation. Did you come across about Skyla, which has a fourth of the dose of progesterone that Mirena has? If there's any link with increased venous thromboembolism in kids that have personal thrombophilic factors, not personal history of clots, but they have, you know, not just factor five, something else was,
That is not something that I read about, that they actually said Mirena and Skylar are very safe, and our pharmacist here may be able to comment more about that. But that they're very safe in those that have a history of clotting disorder.
We are still, Mirena is not a great choice if you're never had a kid. Skyla is now approved to be used in our patient population that's never been, you know, a parent yet. So I probably met 10 teenagers in the last year. That are referred for workup for thrombophilia, either because, you know, the mother had a fee or there's something else, or the GYN wanted to use some sort of contraception and they want us to work up the kid. And we are still, at least myself, but I'm pretty sure Dr. Cathy and Dr. Cook as well, are still uncomfortable to recommend any kind of hormone containing contraception to these kids because of the risk that, you know, if mom had a PE and you find something in the child, you don't want to mess with that. Because venous thromboembolism for us is more important than you know, so we are always saying oral contraception should not be used, but I really don't have a good answer about Skyla, because that dose of progesterone is so little. So you didn't see any studies looking at that.
The other thing to consider is the copper iodine. I didn't talk a lot about it, but it's
is that
hormones
safe
free.
In
I'm sorry?
Is that safe in somebody that never had a child?
So they're saying that all IUDs are safe. I'm not sure about the FDA recommendations as far as using a copper one. I would have to ask the OB and look at that. But it is hormone-free, so it could possibly be an option. And those are good for 12 years. They're just a lot more side effects with heavier bleeding with the copper IUD than with Mirena or Skyla, and that's one reason it's not chosen.
I think it's used a lot.
And just out of curiosity, North Carolina study, did they offer the authors any kind of, did they comment about that finding, why the medical professionals are more likely to approach the subject sex with African Americans versus white?
No, they didn't really comment on that discussion. It was just a kind of a finding that they noticed when they were collecting their data, and I'm not sure they told the providers about that. But it may be related to the fact that first slide that I showed you, that African American teens are more sexually active than the white and Hispanic population.
Okay.